good morning. We are back again. It's a new month, and we have your questions, and we have a lot of things to talk about. And so without any further ado, we're going to get right into that. Joining me, as always, is our brother Randy Johns and our pastor and prophet Don Evans.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. We got a little white stuff all over the ground. Our winter is setting in, I guess. Lots of things are going on in the world. Lots of questions. And I know that we can answer every one for you.
Amen.
Yes, praise the Lord. It was a balmy 15 degrees this morning. Coldest it's been, but it looking to be a nice day here. Praise the Lord. We're going to jump right into our questions, and because we have some other things to talk about as well this morning. Jimmy from Mississippi says, "Dear Mr. Prophet, a friend told me to watch the Jim Baker program because Ivan Baxter would be on all week. He said the last 7 years cannot start until the Antichrist sits on the throne in the new temple. He said we are in the new Roman kingdom right now. He had a lot of things, but they all seemed off the wall, and Baker seemed to agree with him. Please explain what is truth and what is going on."
Well, Mr. Baxter, either his dad or his grandfather, Ern Baxter, started Kingdom Now theology. So he grew up under a lot of that teaching. When he first started out, you know, he was pre, and then he claimed to be mid, and now he definitely is teaching we go all the way through. So when you start teaching we're going all the way through, you have to squeeze, probably hammer, a whole bunch of stuff together to make it come out right. And if you listen to him, and I happened to listen to him because I wanted to see where he was at now, he left off, he named all the kingdoms that would take over up to Rome. Now, when Jesus come, Rome was in charge, you remember? That's in the Bible, very clear. Well, Rome hung on until a fellow by the name of Adolf Hitler, Germany. You can find most, you know, that's the sad part. Most of this stuff can be found right in the history books. Yeah, it's in our Bible. It did happen, but our Bible said it was going to happen long before the history books printed it. So then Germany was the next nation, not Japan, because Japan was just getting started and they were only working on islands and stuff for takeover because they weren't powerful enough to take over anything like Germany was. They had a great navy and a great airport, Air Force, but that was about it. And none of the people on the islands that they overtook basically had any guns or anything. They had, you know, so they had a walkthrough. They may have thought they were powerful, but if you study it, it was kind of a walkthrough. So Japan never got to the place where it would have been taking over the whole world. Germany was. And that's what all these other countries the Bible talks about. They were taking over the whole world in a sense. Who defeated Germany? The United States of America. We did. And you know, they haven't really called the war after the Second World War. They generally call them peace actions or some crazy name because none of them are really trying to take over the whole world. And so we popped in there. Well, there's only seven, according to the Bible, seven nations. We made number six, and we've been in control ever since the war ended. We haven't lost that control. We're seen as the country that is kind of dominant over all the other countries. The next one to take over will be the kingdom of Jesus Christ. There'll be other little fights, wars. We'll see Russia march down. That's the first group that marches down on the Battle of Armageddon. But who is the last? Because Russia gets totally wiped out by God. The last one is China. Everybody's worried about China. Well, China is the last country to come down, and they come down on horseback. Yeah? So that makes number 7. And 7 has always been the biblical number, and 7 is the biblical number yet. And so for another country to take over the whole world until we're rendered helpless, and we are going to be rendered helpless very soon because we will be attacked and there will be great cities that are wiped out, starting with New York City. That's Babylon, the fall in 24 hours. You know, after that, we have almost a whole year, the Lord told us, where revival here in the United States will be going on, but we will not be a superpower and will not be able to help Israel. Remember that. We can't help Israel. And that lasts for almost a whole year. So if you look at that and remember that, that's what happens when you try to move everything to after the 7 years. Or he was teaching very loudly what either his father or grandfather taught, kingdom now theology. I knew him real well. Ern Baxter, one of the best preachers that you ever heard. I mean, he was great when it come to preaching. But when they put all their theology together, they started out with the shepherding movement. And when people found out that was wrong, then they went to the kingdom now theology. And I don't know if people realize that's wrong yet. That should answer your question, I think. Is there anything else I should expound on there?
No, you touched on a lot of important things. And, you know, I know a lot of people seem to get confused on a lot of this stuff. But, you know, if you would just read the Bible, read it as it's written, you know, I think they try to over-spiritualize it at times. And then you look at some of the stuff these people say, and you're like, what? You know, it just totally doesn't make sense.
Well, if you remember, Ern Baxter himself said, first he believed it was, you know, between the third and fourth chapter. Then when he got done reading the next chapter, there it was there. Then he read a little another part, and there it was there. Then he read another part, and there it was there. And he said that the Bible is not a continuous, Revelation is not a continuous book. It's broken up into parts, what confuses us. No, 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 no. Genesis 1 is very deep. Genesis 2 explains Genesis 1. And this is the same thing in the Bible in Revelation. Chapters 1 through 3 up to chapter 4 begins to tell us what took place. And then from 4 on to about 7, he explains all that again. That's all. And it's the same way, because you look at 7, it would look like the rapture took place. But then we get to chapter 11, 12, 13, and 14, we say, wow, this is a rapture. So now we got 3 raptures and only got 1. And then we read from there that when the church comes back and every eye sees him, we'd say, oh, here's the rapture. No, that's when he's coming back to set up his 1,000-year millennial reign. You could call it a rapture if you wanted to. But it only explains what already has been said. So if you read it that way, it becomes much more clearer. Go ahead, David.
You know, that's a very good point, and most people don't understand that. You can see that because you do see a lot of similarities in the book of Revelation when you read. But when you understand that it's just explaining what took place, I think it gives you a better understanding. You know, one thing I can say is in 31 years of following pastor's ministry, his theology on the book of Revelation has always been the same. I don't think it's ever changed.
No.
I think the only thing that's changed is God has given him new revelation about those particular things as far as the Antichrist and the false prophet and different things like that. And, you know, I get a little concerned when people start jumping here, there, and everywhere. They're not even sure what they believe themselves,
no,
and they're just going, what's the latest and greatest teaching? What's everybody else saying? And that is where we can get into trouble.
See, that's where he gets into trouble. Another spot was he saw in Daniel where the books were sealed up.
Mm-hmm.
Well, yeah, they were. They were open, I believe. Now, my personal belief is they opened in 2000. Year 2000, then God began to give us things and show us things more clear. He didn't change it. He just made it more clear to us, and we were seeing what was sealed up in those closed books, and he's still showing us more things today.
Oh, absolutely. Amen.
Amen. That's why we always got to be in the Word.
That's right.
Because God will show you things that you might not have seen before.
Very true. That's a very good point. Praise the Lord. Fred from Georgia says, Mr. Prophet, we sure are seeing a lot of demon activity going on. Is it going to get worse, and how much worse?
Well, sad to say, the answer to that is yes. You remember right after I had my open heart surgery and they replaced a new valve?
Yeah.
I told everybody that I saw demons loosed all over the world. They were jumping around like frogs. They were in the backyard. They vanished and they showed back up. Well, since then, teaching on TV, and I don't watch these things, so I can't name them all to you, but these teachings on TV, like Pokemon, now Pokemon Go, oh, man, there's people all over the United States. Millions are playing with this game, and that game will get you demon-possessed. And people are going to have cast demons out of you. That's why we're seeing, you know, only Black Lives Matter. I mean, a lot of these people got demon-possessed. They're out there killing people.
Yes.
Every time we turn on the television and listen to news anymore, some police officers got shot someplace, even black police officers, white police officers, Mexican police officers, you name it, they've been shot and killed because some people are demon-possessed and they don't know it.
Mm.
And they use the word today, bipolar.
Yes.
That's demon-possessed.
Yep.
They got more than one personality. This personality shows up, and then that personality shows up. That's nothing but demon possession. Man, we dealt with that heavy during the 80s, 70s, 80s, 90s. That was one of the major things we were dealing with. But a lot of those brothers passed away now. They were friends, many of them. And we definitely had a big deliverance ministry. We didn't want to be known as that, but we did. So we understand this. And the more they play Pokemon, the more Harry Potter. Matter of fact, they're building a whole building to Harry Potter. Man, that was all demon possession. We had, you know,
witchcraft
movies way back then. And the schools, the sad part of it, the schools woke up to it before most of the churches. They wouldn't let it happen in their churches no more. And they stopped it. Now it's just come back, The Walking Dead, and you name it. Oh, brother. And all these movies here will cause people to be demon-possessed. At 3:38 a.m. today, God woke me up and started to get me ready for this program here. And he told me some things, and I thought, I hope we can get all the material in. We only had 4 or 5 or 6 people call in or something, you know, write in. So we thought, well, we'll get by. We can talk to you about the Bible. But anyways, he showed me this is going on. Now, there's way too much information for us to give you all this probably in a couple months, because our program's only an hour long, so we only get 1 hour. And that's an awful lot of teaching to try to teach you. So the Lord told me to tell you this. We've never done this before. For a love offering of $20, just put it between one page and put another page over it and just send it to us with your email address. We'll send you teachings and all the stuff we feel you need to have teaching on. Yeah, we'll send you stuff like this that'll get you straight on what Ern Baxter, not Ern, his grandson or son taught you, straighten you out on that you're not confused. There's no demons out there in planets, and they're going to open up some big hole, and it's all going to come down. I mean, God would have told us. You find one place in the Bible where God tells us that. You won't find it. It's not there in the Bible. This is man's imagination running wild. I mean, when demon activity is really running wild, you see all types of manifestations. One friend of mine saw a whole church, every pew in that church, lifted, wasn't fastened to the floor, with people in, was lifting up and floating in the air because a warlock was in there controlling it. And he said, I command you in the name of Jesus Christ to come down and stay down. And they all come down and they stayed down.
Amen.
Now, people could blow that way out of proportion. But that was what was happening. And he I haven't talked to my video text yet, because I say 3:38 in the morning, you're getting all this. But he also said that all that money you send is not going to me, it's going to our building project. We're in a building project right now. We've got to raise a little over $1 million, and God will do that. We're not worried about that. But anyways, one gift of $20, your email address. And when we do the dedication services, I said services, because it'll probably be more than one or maybe 2 or 3 days, I don't know. They'll make sure that you can get one of these videos that you can watch without us having to send you anything other than the attachment form. So you get all this for that one gift. But the Lord said to tell you it's only good until the 1st of April, because after the 1st of April, we won't need that. Mm. I mean, God's got people now that's ready to send their money in. I got a crazy email yesterday, and I'm trying to check it out. It didn't give me nothing, only I can use the return address up there. Said, we're sorry, our check was returned to us for $1 million. We had to get a hold of our bank to find out what was wrong. But you'll have another check in a few days. And it didn't tell me who or where. And it could have been just some fake. Yeah, it could be real. So we're not going to need it later down the road. But that's what we'll do for you. Now, you can always come back and watch this tape if you forgot some of this. And hear it again. Because we won't repeat it again. The Lord told me not to repeat it again. Unless we repeat it in our church. Because there's people that watch us on there too. So we're just throwing this out here at you. These guys aren't even aware of it yet. And all you do is just stick that $20 bill in between a paper folded up 3 times and another one folded up 3 times over it. Address that, put your email address on there, and we'll take care of the rest. That's all. You don't have to worry about us sending letters to you for money. We never do that anyways. And $20, he told me to throw in my one book, All the Promises of God. Way back in 1970, we sold that for $50 in a small leatherback bound book. So just that one alone, you're getting more than your $20 worth. So it'll be a good deal for you. Go ahead, back to you, David.
Well, praise the Lord. Definitely, definitely is a good deal, especially if you want some things to study. He's going to give you more than you even think. Praise
That's
the Lord.
Right.
Amen.
Remember, he's going to give you what the Lord said you need. That's the important thing.
That's right. That'll be on demon possession and end time. Randy's going to share a little bit, depending on how much time we have today, right here on one of the studies.
Yep. Just remember what God said, blessed are the hungry, for they shall be filled.
Yes.
Amen. Amen.
And can we do that, Kevin? Can we make them the dedication services so they just get it on a attachment form and open up and can watch it?
Yeah, we can take care of that. We can take care of that video.
I see. You know, it's extremely important that all of you, if you're not filled with the Holy Spirit, get filled with the Holy Spirit. Because the Bible teaches us very clearly that if we're not filled with the Holy Spirit, then our human flesh wars with our spirit, which is the Holy Spirit. And it says we can't understand, we can't know spiritual truths, and that's why we've got so many out there that are all confused and mixed up. I mean, I have Perry Stone, he calls me and wants to know this and that. John Shorey calls me, wants to know this and that. Ivan is his name, Ivan. He even called me once. They wanted to get the three of us on a debate on television, and I told them, no, thank you. I'm not there to argue about it. If they want to learn, I'll be more than glad to teach them.
Yep. The problem today is everybody wants to sit and argue with each other instead of working together.
That's right.
And finding out where the truth lies.
True, and actually, you know, when you sometimes you can maybe do more harm than good in those cases, because the people watching, they're going to believe what they see, not necessarily what's the truth.
True, and if you're playing one of these games or watching these programs on television, the chances are pretty good that you got demon possessed and don't even know it.
Hmm.
So that demon is going to fight any and everything that's spiritual that you won't grow.
Hmm.
They'll try to destroy you. That's very called true. The falling away. You read that in Revelation? That's just before the Antichrist is revealed. Matter of fact, this study here leads right up to who this Antichrist is, but I don't include that part in it because I figure this is way too much for this program anyways, but we'll see. Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Sam from Washington, D.C. says, Dear Mr. Prophet, the Bible tells us that God puts those into office and he removes them. So being God put Donald Trump into office, are people putting too much faith, trust, and confidence in him? Now, if God put him
out there, first of all, right there, I'd say yes.
Yep.
I believe he's the one that God wanted. I believe that. But people are expecting way too much from him.
True.
And there's only so much that he can do. He's still got a Democratic Congress and Senate and a Republican Congress and Senate and a undenominational, whatever they call them, Congress and Senate. There's some people there that don't belong to either party. And so if they are hearing from God, they'll follow him. The more they follow him, the better we'll have it until the church is raptured out of here. But the less, and you already see how much they're fighting him right now. Matter of fact, he was in Michigan last night, and they had to take about 50 people out of the thing because they just come. They didn't come. He's thanking people for what they done for him. So they come there to protest. They have no right being in a thank you service. Years ago, we wouldn't have allowed that, you know? And we see they're fighting him at every turn, at every turn. They haven't, he's not even president yet, not until January.
Mm. But you can see how the world's looking for that one man that is not Jesus.
That's right. You're
looking for the one that's going to appease everything that they want to hear and do.
That's the Antichrist.
And that'll make them happy, but it's not going to be Jesus.
See, the Antichrist comes in two stages, and apparently people haven't been taught that either. At first, he's Mr. Nice Guy. He's got a lot of nice answers. It's not Donald Trump. And second of all, he's got to be a Muslim Jew. He's got to be Jewish lineage. If not, he's not the Antichrist. It's not Germany. It's not the Pope. It's not that nonsense that people are trying to sell you. And we know who he is. We've told you before. And boy, he's right in there. He's Hellenistic, and he's a king, and he's in control of the temple. He is number one man in control of all that ground up there. And right now, you'd think he was Mr. Nice Guy.
Yes, you would. In fact, when you listen to him speak,
oh, he yes. Said,
you would almost think he was a born-again Christian the way he talks, but he's probably not. He talks about his God that way.
That's
probably
right.
He actually is a nice guy until Satan comes in.
Yep, then Satan comes in, just like we're warning you about here. Only this is Satan, it says. The Bible clearly says Satan comes in. It doesn't say a spirit. Satan. And then he makes a huge change.
And the last part of Sam's question, now if God put him into office, are the people who are still fighting God, and will this bring more judgment on America?
I'd say yes again. Because the Bible clearly tells us that God puts the people in office and he takes them out of office. It's been that way from the beginning of time. Sometimes they're a good person, sometimes they're a bad. It depends on what the people want. You can see that in the life of Saul.
Yep.
They wanted Saul because he's head and shoulders over every person. He was the tallest person. What happened? An evil spirit got into him, and oh, wow. Whew. Read it in the Bible. Yes, he went the wrong way.
Yes.
So we see this. So we need to be in prayer. The Bible's always told us to pray for our presidents, our governors, our leaders, that they'll do what God wants them to do and not what they want to do. Would somebody was spirit-filled be far better as president? No. You say, what? Well, again, it depends on where they're sitting and getting their teaching. If they're getting their teaching where they think they're the only denomination in the world, then they're going to pass laws that are going to make you go to their church and do what they believe, regardless what's in the Bible or not. And we don't want that type of dictator. Herod, remember him? Herod? He thought he was Christ too. He killed John the Baptist. He was instrumental in helping to see that Christ was crucified. We see that. Bible's full of examples.
Very true. Richard from Southern California says, Mr. Prophet, could you please settle this confusion? When the Bible said, behold, he cometh and every eye shall see him, what was that at the time when the body of Christ returns for 3.5 years in heaven to set up the 1,000-year reign, not the rapture?
Now, I could let anybody in this room explain that one to you. I'm not putting you down. You know, I understand churches don't seem to know the truth. But if you're reading where the rapture takes place, you notice that we're caught away to meet him where?
In the air.
In the air, in the clouds. Not every eye sees him.
True.
Matter of fact, probably half the world don't even no, it happened until it happens.
Wonder where everybody went.
Yeah, and they're wondering, what happened? Where'd all these people go?
They're abducted now, by aliens.
Now, after we've been in heaven for 3.5 years, starting with chapter 15 in Revelation, you begin to notice it says raft, 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 raft 13 times. The raft has come. And then you go on a little farther, down around chapter 18, 19, 21, you know, all at once, this great army that was in heaven, all these people that were saved, comes riding back on white horses. And the Bible is very clear, and it says, every eye shall see him. You remember they want to hide under rocks and everything, yep, and call them down to, yes, fall on them because they're scared? Well, he's coming back to stop everything that's going on and set up his thousand-year millennial reign. Now, after the thousand-year millennial reign, is the white throne judgment, when all the people that didn't come back with Christ riding on white horses are judged. The dead, the living, everyone, those that made it through a thousand-year millennial reign, we haven't seen that yet. Of course, those that have gone to heaven, we don't sit in that judgment. We may be there to watch, but we're saved already. And so that's the difference between the two. That's why one of them is way over in the last part of the book of Revelation. And the other one, you see it mentioned all the way up to chapter 14. Then after that, it's a different story. Go ahead, David.
Yeah. You know, in the second part, he says, isn't it true when the church goes, only those going shall see him in the clouds and not the world?
Amen.
You know, you're absolutely 100% right, and that's where the confusion comes in. I know it's, you know, in Matthew there, it gives a clear, it talks about that and talks about some things in Matthew 24, and that's why people get confused. But when you look at the difference, when every eye should see him, that isn't what the Bible tells us in the rapture. That tells us when the whole world sees him.
And you notice that we've explained Matthew 24 to you before. The Bible clearly says that Jesus does not know when the rapture is going to take place. The only one that does is the Father.
It's true.
So in Matthew 24... he doesn't speak about the rapture in that sense at all.
Good point.
When it comes down to that verse, he says, every eye shall see him when he comes. Well, that's when he comes to set up his thousand-year millennial reign.
So somewhere in there, the church goes.
That's right.
That's very true, and that's a very key point, and you know, if you think about it that way, you know, I think it could help to give a little bit more understanding why he was speaking in reference to that in that portion of Scripture.
And Mr. Baxter also said that the temple has to be rebuilt and established on the mount and have their first service when the Antichrist commits the abomination of desolation. Well, if you read over in Revelation 12, 13, and 14, you'll see this. That happens just before or at the same time that the church is raptured out.
Very true.
And yet he takes you, that's the beginning of the 7 years.
Yes, very true.
That's what he says. That's the beginning of the 7 years. No. We've already been in there. This is going on for 3.5 years. There's only 3.5 years left. God said if he didn't shorten the time, even the very elect would be deceived.
Yes, true.
But we got that once saved, always saved. Right?
It's like doing your oil one time in your car and expecting never
the car never break down.
It don't matter. We've already did the oil.
There's no such thing as once saved, always saved. If there was, back in Noah's day, all those people left behind would have been saved.
True. True.
It's going to be the same way when the church goes out. When God closes the door, the door's going to stay closed.
In fact, they're not going to know until it's already done and over with.
That's right.
Then it'll be too late.
Now, okay. Think about when you do the white throne judgment. How many years is that going to take to judge everybody? It talks about the sea giving up the dead and them.
Oh, yes.
And think of all the people that have died throughout the years. And
then after that, to show you some of these teachers, you see some of them aren't prophets. They're prophetic teachers. They're not a prophet. They're a prophetic teacher. There's a big difference. There's a big difference. They teach on what they have been taught or what they believe, and they're not a prophet, so they don't know. A lot claim to be prophets, but they're not prophets. They're not. Matter of fact, we had a funeral, and we had two Baptist preachers there, and I was sharing with them. Neither one of them were spirit-filled, and they didn't believe in it. And they didn't believe you could be lost. And we had a little child vanish. So I got those two, along with some other people, along with his wife, Noelle, that brought us the word, a little child was vanished. It's dark outdoors. It was really dark. So we joined hands together, and I prayed. And then in my prayer, without, you know, this is God praying, I said, Lord, wherever the child is, wake them up, have them manifest themselves to their parents. Yeah. And we thank you for that. Well, the child was up in the house behind the couch on the floor sleeping. And within 2 minutes, the answer had come and all been fulfilled. And I'm thinking those two Baptists are probably scratching their heads and saying, how in the world did he know? God, right, a prophet. Amen. You know, God, not me. Right. God.
Amen.
You know, and that's what's funny sometimes, because you hear yourself saying things and then you, did that really come out of my mouth?
Yeah.
But I believe that's just another situation that God allowed to happen so that he could show himself.
Oh, yes.
So,
amen.
The two other ministers.
See, we got two upcoming prophets right here. Very good ones.
Zane's coming up.
Oh, yeah. We got a little boy. He is really coming up. Are we done with that?
Yeah, that was all our questions. So you want to share?
You want to read some of that? What time we got left?
We got about 20 minutes.
Really? I'll see how far you can read in 20 minutes.
So Randy's going to read out of Daniel, Daniel chapter 8, out of Pastor's Notes of Daniel, talking about the little horn and the sanctuary cleansed.
Daniel helps you understand the book of Revelation. Without Daniel, you don't understand the book of Revelation. You need to read Daniel.
Amen.
Daniel chapter 8. The little horn and the sanctuary cleansed. Daniel 8, 1 through 2. In the third year of the reign of King Belshazzar, a vision appeared unto me, even unto me, Daniel, after that which appeared unto me at the first. And I saw in a vision, and it came to pass, when I saw, that I was at Shushan in the palace, which is in the province of Elam. And I saw in a vision, and I was by the river of Ulay.
Now this is the Bible talking. This is not my commentary on it yet. A lot of this is just the Bible talking.
King Belshazzar only reigned for 3 years. And if you remember back to chapter 5, it was during his rulership that the Babylonian Empire crumbled under the hands of the Medes and Persians. So we find this vision coming to Daniel in the final year of the reign of Belshazzar and the Babylonian Empire. Also, this vision...
That was the first empire to fall.
Also, this vision is 2 years after the one that appeared unto Daniel at the first in chapter 7. Daniel was located in the palace at Shushan, which was the metropolis of the province of Elam, near the river Ulay. The king of Babylon had a palace situated there which would not make it a strange occurrence for Daniel to be there. For with the position that Daniel held in the kingdom, it would easily indicate that he was there fulfilling the king's business. Eberdates was prince of the province of Elam, which lies east of Babylon. He later revolted and sided with Cyrus the Persian. Thus, Elam becoming a province of Persia, who linked up with the Medes to conquer Babylon. Note, Elam's involvement was prophesied of by Isaiah, Isaiah 21, 2. Daniel 8, 3 through 4. Then I lifted up mine eyes and saw, and behold, there stood before the river a ram which had two horns. And the two horns were high, but one was higher than the other. And the higher came up last. I saw the ram pushing westward and northward and southward, so that no beasts might stand before him. Neither was there any that could deliver out of his hand. But he did according to his will and became great. A ram, the first power introduced to us in this chapter, is symbolized by a ram. There is no guessing who this is, for in verse 20 we are told that it is the kingdom of the Medes and Persians.
Now who was that? The Medes and the Persians. The Bible tells us that, all right? He even admits that that's the second kingdom.
So unlike chapters 2 and 7, this vision starts without the kingdom of Babylon. The reason being that Babylon was at the end of its reign of world dominance. It was passing off the scene, which had two horns. Again, in verse 20, we are told that the two horns are the kings of Media and Persia. One was higher than the other. Higher came up last. The Medes under Darius and the Persians under Cyrus untied together to bring about the downfall of the Babylonian Empire. Probably united together. When they succeeded, as seen in chapter 5, Cyrus, the nephew of Darius the Mede, allowed Darius to take the throne and rule the empire. Out of respect for his uncle, Darius ruled for only 2 years and then died at the age of 64. Persia now took the throne through Cyrus. But why is this referred to as the higher coming up last? It is because out of the two nations, the Medes were the weaker, and thus the higher or stronger, which were the Persians, came up last. The kingdom eventually was known as the Persian Kingdom. Pushed westward, northward, and southward. When looking at the word pushed here and the way it is used in this verse, it is easy to see that it is referring to the conquests of the Medo-Persian Empire. The Medes and Persians conquered Lydia to the west in 547 BC.
Now you can read this in the history books that they have around them if they haven't destroyed them.
And Babylon in 539 BC. Egypt and Nubia in the south in 525 BC, and the Scythians in the north in 513 BC. The entire number of provinces were 127, Esther 1:1, from India to Ethiopia. No beast might stand before him. That is, no nation could stand before the Medo-Persian Empire. Did according to his will. No one could stand in the way of, nor be delivered out of the hand of this conquering power, which did according to his will and became great. Daniel 8, 5 through 8. And as I was considering, behold, an he-goat came from the west on the face of the whole earth and touched not the ground. And the goat had a notable horn between his eyes, and he came to the ram that had two horns, which I had seen standing before the river, and ran unto him in the fury of his power.
Now, a lot of people will throw in that, let's come by an airplane. No, 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 I'll explain that to you.
And I saw him come close unto the ram, and he was moved with choler against him, and smote the ram, and brake his two horns. And there was no power in the ram to stand before him, but he cast him down to the ground, and stamped upon him, and there was none that could deliver the ram out of his hand. Therefore, the he-goat waxed very great. And when he was strong, the great horn was broken. And for it came up four notable ones toward the four winds of heaven. As I was considering, as Daniel was watching the ram, behold, an he-goat. Daniel is now introduced to the next power while watching the ram, thus showing that these are consecutive kingdoms. Once again, there is no guessing who this is, for we are told in verse 21 that the he-goat is the kingdom of Grecia, or Greece, under the rulership of Alexander the Great. Came from the west. Greece was to the west. On the face of the whole earth, thus showing that Greece was to be a world-dominating power. Touched not the ground. Greece was to cover the face of the whole earth in a short space of time. Hence, the wording, touched not the ground. Under Alexander, they did this in 12 short years, conquering everything from Macedonia to India and south to Egypt, marching his army over 8,364 kilometers during the 12 years. Notable horn between his eyes. From verse 21, we see that this notable horn is the first king. History tells us that this was Alexander the Great. Came to the ram, fury of his power, moved with the choler. The Bible describes the goat as coming to the ram in the fury of his power and being moved with the choler against him. Why? Here is a comment from Adam Clark's commentary on Daniel to show the reason.
I think that's the best commentary out there myself. I love Adam Clark.
Speaking of Alexander, he says, subdued Persia and Media, sacked and burnt the royal city of Persepolis, the capital of the Persian Empire, and even in its ruins, it is one of the wonders of the world to the present day. This he did because he was moved with choler against Darius, who had endeavored to draw off his captives with bribes and had labored to induce some of his friends to assassinate him. Alexander, finding this, would listen to no proposals of peace and was determined never to rest till he had destroyed Darius and his whole empire. In Media, Darius was seized and made prisoner by some of his own treacherous subjects and afterwards basely murdered. Adam Clark's commentary on Daniel, page 597, 1823 and 24. We also find that when an official entourage appealed for consolation, they were handed the famous reply, "Heaven cannot support two sons, nor the earth two masters." From the rest of verse 7, it is easy to see that Alexander utterly destroyed the Medo-Persian Empire, for the Bible says that he smote the ram, brake his two horns, no power in the ram, cast him down, stomped upon him, none that could deliver the ram.
I couldn't be much more destroyed, could you?
Blown up.
Notice, no nuclear wars, no nothing there. It's...
Alexander's empire covered Greece and Macedonia in the west and east through to almost the Indus River. Then south through Syria, Jordan, Palestine, and Egypt. Therefore, the he-goat waxed very great, because Alexander's kingdom covered a greater territory than the Medes and Persians, and the fact that he conquered them, Greece is regarded as waxing very great. When he was strong, horn was broken. When the empire was at its peak in strength, Alexander died in a drunken debauch at about the age of 31. Just before his death, he was asked to whom the kingdom would go. The reply came back that it would go to the strongest. For it came up four notable ones. In verse 22, we see that these four notable horns are four kings' kingdoms. They were not to stand up in the power of Alexander. That is, they did not have to conquer land that was unconquered to extend their territory, and not one man was to rule all. Initially, the entire kingdom went to Alexander's natural brother, Philip Aretas, and then to his two infant sons, Alexander, Agis, and Hercules. Within a very short time, these were all killed, so there was no natural heir to the throne, and the battle ensued between the 36 generals for control of the kingdom. Eventually, it was divided between four, exactly as the prophecy stated. These were Cassander, who had Macedonia and Greece in the west, Lysimachus, who had Thrace and a large part of Asia Minor in the north, Ptolemy, who had Egypt, and a part of Syria in the south. Seleucus, who had the bulk of the Persian Empire from Syria eastward. Towards the four winds of heaven, that is, towards the four points of the compass, north, south, east, and west. Jeremiah 49:36. Daniel 8:9-11. And out of one of them came forth a little horn, which waxed exceeding great, toward the south, and toward the east, and toward the pleasant land. And it waxed great, even to the host of heaven. And it cast down some of the host and of the stars to the ground, and stomped upon them. Yes, he magnified himself even to the prince of the host. And by him the daily sacrifice was taken away, and the place of his sanctuary was cast down. Let's have a look at some of the identifying marks of this little horn. It came out of one of the four winds, not the four horns. So this power was not going to arise out of the Grecian Empire. Waxed exceeding great. Medo-Persia was great. Greece was very great. But this little horn was to be exceeding great, which is greater than all the other powers before it. Toward the south, Egypt, toward the east, Syria, and toward the pleasant land, Jeremiah 3 speaks of Israel and Judah in idolatry. And the Lord asked them in verse 19, how can he give them the pleasant land which was Palestine, even to the host of heaven, and it cast down some of the host and of the stars to the ground? Verse 24 reads, mighty and holy people. Obviously, God's people are being stomped upon. Stars in Revelation 1:20 are referred to as the angels, messengers to the churches, which are the leaders of the churches. So not only did this power stomp upon God's people, but also upon some of his leaders. Magnified himself even to the prince of the host, prince of princes, in verse 25. This power was to even crucify Christ, the prince of God's people. From verse 23, we see the following. Toward the end of the reign of the four kingdoms, kings, another nation was to stand up or take control. Notice the identifying marks. King of fierce countenance and understanding dark sentences. In Deuteronomy 28:47-51, Moses is giving a prophecy of the nation that would finally destroy Israel. In it, we see the same identifying marks, plus a couple more. Put a yoke of iron upon their neck, whose tongue thou shalt not understand, and a nation of fierce countenance. Also, we need to focus on the principle of repeat and enlarge, as seen in chapters 2 and 7. So what power arose from outside of the Grecian Empire? Rome, as it was not part of Alexander's kingdom, waxed exceeding great, greater than all the powers before it. Rome had a greater dominion than any other kingdom prior to it. Rome conquered Egypt in the south in 30 BC, Syria, Jordan in the east in 65 BC, and Palestine in 63 BC. Who cast down some of God's people and his leaders to the ground? This refers to the persecution and attacks made by Rome on the Jews.
How much time?
This also speaks of Herod, who was the king of the Jews, who hated Jesus. We also see a reference to Revelation 12:4, where the great red dragon, a symbol of Rome, and again also of King Herod, who cast a third of the stars of heaven to the ground. This was a reference to the taking away of one-third of the power of self-rulership from the Jewish nation, the one-third of which was the royalty, leaving the Sanhedrin and the priesthood. Did Rome crucify Christ? No. Psalms 2:1-2 and Acts 4:25-27 show that even though the Jews plotted and orchestrated Christ's death, they still had to gain the authority from Pilate Herod to carry out the crucifixion. Also, it was Herod's iron monarchy that put a heavy yoke about Israel's neck until the time that Rome destroyed them. Plus, the language that was not known or familiar to them was Greek, as Hebrew and Chaldean were most common to the Jews. But we need to remember from chapter 7 that Rome has two phases, pagan and papal. And this little horn is broken without hand in verse 25, which is a clear reference to the second coming at a much later date. The words taken away come from the Hebrew word rum, which means bring up, raise, lift up, set up, and exalt. In Daniel 4:37, it is translated as extol, and 5:19 and 23, set up and lifted up. 11:36, exalt. So this taking away of the daily is not a destruction of it, but an exaltation of it. If you look in your Bible, the word sacrifice is in italics, which indicates that it is wholly a supplied word by the translators. It is not there in the original text. In the Hebrew, the word means perpetual or continual, and found to be in the noun form, which means that it is a naming word. From verse 13, it is easily seen that the daily is paganism. The papacy took paganism to itself and exalted it under the garb of Christianity. The Antichrist, who is Muslim, Jewish, will do the same. So by the papal form of Rome, the pagan form was taken away. Pagan Rome was remodeled into papal Rome. This is why we only see one little horn to describe the two powers, for in reality one is just a continuation of the other. Also note that it also implies another little horn. Notice the following quote. Whatever Roman elements the barbarians and Arians left were put under the protection of the Bishop of Rome, who was the chief person there after the emperor's disappearance. The Roman Church in this way privily pushed itself into the place of the Roman world empire. Yet the empire has not perished, but has only undergone a transformation. That is no mere clever remark, but the recognition of the true state of the matter historically and the most appropriate and fruitful way of describing the character of this church. It still governs the nations. It is a political creation and is imposing as a world empire. Because a continuation of the Roman Empire, the Pope, who calls himself King and Pontifex Maximus, is Caesar's successor, Adolf Harnack, which is Christianity. What is Christianity?
What page, John?
There's no numbers on
it. How much time do you got left?
You got a couple minutes.
Okay, I'll give a comment from here. This goes on until a fellow by the name of Adolf Hitler. He destroyed Rome. He took over. He took over everybody overseas in a war. And we got into that war with him before Japan bombed Pearl Harbor. Before. And the Germans began to rule everything. Until the United States of America defeated Germany and defeated Japan and became the supreme rule over all the world. And we're still there today. So that if that is true, and it is, we're going to be destroyed. And as we said that before, Babylon's going to fall in a 24-hour period, and I believe it'll start with New York City and other places, along with the earthquakes and the divisions, and we'll be rendered where we can't help Israel. There's no way we'll be able to help Israel. They're not trusting in God, but God has a covenant with them, so he's going to fulfill his covenant. And about the time that Mr. Baxter had the 7 years just starting, well, the church is being taken out. The Jews are fleeing from the holy city and hiding in Petra, where they'll remain for 3.5 years. The ones that don't go to Petra will be killed. Maybe all of them, maybe only part of them. And that'll remain until Jesus Christ comes back with his army to set up his 1,000-year millennial reign. Now, we went over that earlier, so now it should all be clear.
Yep.
Go ahead, David.
You know, it's very true. There's a lot of important things that you find out when you begin to study God's Word and find out what's really truth and what's not. And then you can start to even have a clearer picture of what these false teachers are saying and how, you know,
Let me interrupt just a second right in here. Another thing you'll find out, if it's true, it will agree with our history books.
True.
Because God don't lie. And so what some of them are trying to bring down, we don't have in our history books at all. You can go to Grecian theology and find these myths and stuff about these demons, the giants and the heavens and all this garbage.
Yeah.
But you won't find it in the Bible, and you won't find it in world history.
True. Although they are trying to change history books.
They're trying.
True.
Very and it true. Could be getting in there now. I don't know. That's why you need to send your kids to a Christian school that believes the Word of God. You need to get in a church where the gifts of the Spirit are in operation. Because Ephesians 4:11 says there's a fivefold ministry. Apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, teacher. If you haven't got all five of them in your church or coming through your church, then you're not a New Testament church. I'll get a lot of flack for that, but it's what the Bible says.
True.
Go ahead, Dale. Yep. Back to you again.
That's all right. You know, it is true, you know, that we need to be careful about some of these things, but we need to test them against what the Word says.
That's right.
Against what history, what's been done in history. I mean, a lot of these things, like Pastor was showing you here, he was showing you things right from history that lined up 100% with what was being said, with what took place. There's no question about that. But you really do need to be careful, because I know there's a lot of things out there. And if something sounds kind of fishy, yeah, put it on the shelf for a while until you find out for sure.
This study goes on to talk about the first Antichrist. And we got a study that hooks onto this one that takes you from that Antichrist way back there that destroyed the temple in Jerusalem, Antiochus Epiphanes, and it takes you from Antiochus Epiphanes all the way to the Antichrist of today. Bloodline is all there.
Yes.
All there. All there.
Very true. Very true. Yep. I believe that's in chapter 11 of the book of Daniel, which is a little farther along. Well, I want to thank you for joining with us today. Thank you for sending in your questions. That is why we're here. That's why we're doing this program. We want to help you. We want to settle some of these debates that you have going on in your own heart and mind because of the things that you're hearing. So if you have questions, if you want to know something, you can write us. You can leave a message in our guest book. That's how most people like to do it. However you want to do it. Visit us at www.reigningone.org. Check out all our links there. We have links to the video pages also. Not only the videos that we produce here on Talk with the Prophet, but also the videos that we produce at our church and different things like that. So once again, we thank you for joining with us, and we will see you next time on Talk with a Prophet. We'll see you again in 2017.
God bless. Merry Christmas.
Amen.